most widely cited international comparison test and would put us solidly average, even among the industrial nations, maybe on the low average side, as you suggest. Now, there are lots of folks who would argue with that, that's not the best test, that there are lots of other measures, that there are lots of other things going on that make that a more complicated picture. But our sort of assumption that we start out with the greatest and best education system in the world, surprise, surprise, the way that I'm completely backed up. Higher education now is different. In the United States, it's pretty much the assumed world leader in higher education. And isn't that a funny dilemma? How can we be so below average or solidly average in K-12 and yet be really a world leader in higher education?
So here's a little secret with that piece of information you shared, because that's a very important piece that you shared. Where does the United States stand in comparison to our peers around the world in education? Let me link up two things that were set apart. You're raising this issue, and you raised the issue of what happens in low-performing schools. Low-performing schools traditionally in low-economically performing areas, right? So if you take that same data that Ann mentioned, take that same data, the PISA data, and you look at it by an interesting metric, and that metric is zip code. Why zip code? Why would we look at that data by zip code? What do you think? Yeah.
Zip code represents the location in the U.S.
So location? What does the location infer, potentially?
That certain areas like bring down averages for these kind of tests.
Yeah. The thing I'm thinking about with zip code is a proxy for, at least one proxy for, could be income. You can segregate communities by zip code and infer income. If you take that same PISA data and you look at it by zip code, and you divide those zip codes into quartiles, the highest economic areas, the lowest economic areas, where do you think we rank in the highest quartiles in the world, United States and PISA data? Particularly in STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics. Where do you think we rank in the world? What do you think?
Somebody guess.
31st.
What's that?
31st.
31st, okay. What other guesses do we have? Yeah.
17.
17, okay. We're getting warmer. What else? Another guess. Yeah.
23rd.
23rd. All right, here's the secret. If you look at the schools in the most wealthiest regions of the United States, segregating that data by zip code, the top performing schools in the United States rank as the top schools in the world. What about the lowest quartile? So make somebody else's point. Yeah, what do you say? 80th? Probably about right. Probably right near the bottom.
Not so good.
Not so good. So on average, our schools are pretty average, but our range is really, really broad. And that's another point for your debate, perhaps, is why is it that some students who have the opportunity to live and go to school in a economically advantaged part of our country, why are they able to attend a high-performing school that could be classified as one of the best schools in America? How many of you know Thomas Jefferson High School here in Fairfax County? How many of you go to TJ? Go to TJ? One? You go to TJ? You're going in the fall. Great school. Generally considered right in one of the top schools in the country.
Absolutely.
And one of the top schools in the country. How about Montgomery Blair, Montgomery County, Maryland? Kind of the TJ of the Maryland side of the river here. Great schools. Great, some of the very, very best public schools in the country.
And lots of the other high schools in this area, Northern Virginia's got some of the top high schools in the nation. Absolutely.
And then Ann can take you to schools in the Commonwealth of Virginia, or we take you to schools in District of Columbia that are within shouting distance, virtually, of Thomas Jefferson, that aren't nearly performing at the same level.
And yet you think, you know, so what's going on when we get these international comparisons? Because there's poverty everywhere, right? But I think it would be an interesting question as you all work through your year to think about, well, what's different in other nations? One thing Mark pointed out is that Ginsburg pointed out that we've got a wider range, so some countries are more homogenous. Every everybody more in the middle, more like the gaps between the have and have-nots not so great. That's one thing that's making, one needs to factor in and understanding these international comparisons. Another is some countries somehow exclude the folks at the low end of the scale, so they're not even taking their pieces because they're not showing up in school at all. Maybe really rural communities don't have kids in school at all or don't have the testing experience. Our country's actually doing a pretty good job, despite challenges, of we've really moved our dropout rates way down, our graduation rates way up. But now we're keeping kids in school whose earlier generations and equivalents might have left school at 9th or 10th grade and gone straight into the workforce. Now we know that everybody needs to get a high school degree and beyond in order to be able to have family-sustaining wages. But if folks who didn't used to be in school at all are now in school, guess what? You might be bringing some of those averages down because they are the folks who might be academically struggling. So are we more inclusive in some ways than some of those other countries? And yet, do we not deal with poverty as well as some of those other countries? Even some of those other countries that do have real poverty, are they addressing it in a more community-wide way, whereas we're leaving a lot of it for the schools to deal with?
How about one more quote? Then we'll talk about some of the issues. One more quote. What do you think of this one? Education is the engine of democracy. Sharon Robinson said this in a recent speech that she gave. Sharon Robinson, for the last decade, was the president of the American Association of Colleges and Teacher Education, and before that was a senior official at the U.S. Department of Education. And in a speech that she gave just about 6 months ago, soon after the inauguration actually, she gave a stirring address about why education is so important to our country. And essentially what she repeated over and over again is that education is the engine that drives democracy. That an informed citizenry is what makes democracy click.
Anybody see anything in how our democracy is functioning that might connect to that? Some of the, how do we ferret out what's real news and what's not, right? How do we assess the value of information we're getting? We have information at our fingertips, right? But now all of a sudden we have so much information we have to figure out how to discern truth from, I was growing up back in the olden days. We had three network TV anchors. You know, there was Roger Mudd, there was Walter Cronkite, I can't remember the David Brinkley. And right. So if somebody came out with some crazy fake thing about where the president was born in the 1960s, Walter Cronkite would have come on TV and said, "It's just not true, folks. Calm down. He was born in Hawaii and he's a United States citizen." And that would be the end of that discussion. People had trust and faith in these news sources. Now we have such a multiplicity of news sources and we don't trust any of them. Or at least we don't collectively own any of them. So education as a way to help all of us be able to discern our own truths and figure out what we believe and what we place value on and how do we get good, valid information.
You're sitting here today in one of Virginia's great public research universities. What makes this university great? Our reliance on science, our reliance on evidence, our reliance on fact. And if education, as Anne was saying, is the engine of our democracy, then education is about helping us to understand truth from fiction, to understand what science is all about. So let's talk about ed policy a little bit. Anne, you work in this sphere quite a bit. Maybe you can talk a little bit about
this. Yeah, so, and I love the fact that you all's question this year is all about what should the federal government, should it be increasing, upping its expectations or play in education world? So I'm going to start out with a question to you all. I think everybody knows that, well, I'll tell you, that federal, state, and local governments all have a role to play in education, which I'm sure you know, and all play a role already in education policy, all play a role in education funding. but they're pretty fundamentally different. So here's my question to you. Take a guess. What do you think the breakdown, what share of public education, K-12 education funding comes from local, state, and federal shares? Who wants to take a guess? Let's start with federal. What percentage of education funding comes from the feds? Yes, ma'am.
Below
10%. Bingo, you're right.
You guys are so smart
and well-informed. A lot of people make the opposite assumption. In Virginia, my state that I know best, we spend about $17 billion a year, that's billion with a B, on public education. One point about that is that it is the biggest expense for every state and local government. Pretty much on average, at least all across the nation, that would be true.
That's a really important point. Say that again, that's really significant.
Education is the biggest expense for every state and local government.
Wow.
Not true for the feds, right? So in Virginia, $17 billion, of that, about $1 billion comes from the feds, which is a lot of money. If the feds wiped it out, it would be very, very difficult loss to absorb, but it's really about 6-7% of our statewide spending on education. The rest of it, the other $16 billion, is theoretically half and half, basically, with the state. The state says we'll pay slightly more than half of education funding, slightly more than half of what it costs to do a minimally adequate education. But meanwhile, we define minimally adequate quite high, and so we require the localities to spend more than that, as they should, and then the state doesn't pay our share of the bill. So it really comes out to about $9 billion coming from the localities and $7 billion coming from the state. So $1 billion, $9 billion localities, $7 billion state. So to really the two points, a lot of money, but the control, a lot of the decision making, a lot of the funding decisions are happening at the local level, which comes back to our zip codes and our economic disparity issues, right? So if a lot of money is coming from local levels, in some communities, if you've got haves and have-not communities, then that rolls out through education policy.
What about the policy process, where decisions are made? What Ann talked about was dollars. Now, oftentimes saying politics, follow the money. You follow the money, you can follow the decision. So where then, if you follow that money trail, where are most of the decisions made about education? What do you think? The money is mostly local money. Where are most of the decisions being made?
At the local level.
And how does that play out? Who makes a lot of these decisions? We have feds putting regulations out there about various programs, but most of the federal education policies are really not about what's happening in the classroom. And what about from a state secretary point of view? How much responsibility and authority do you have over what happened in classrooms throughout Virginia?
Yeah, so it's funny because one of the reasons I got hired for my job was because it turns out the Secretary of Education has very little actual authority. And one of the reasons I got recruited for the job is because I'd done some other jobs before where I had the value of the bully pulpit, but not a whole lot of direct authority. And prior to previous secretaries of education, they found the job frustrating because guess what? Local school boards don't think I get to tell them what to do. They're elected, they're making their own decisions. Guess what? University presidents don't think I get to tell them what to do. Also, yeah, under my bailiwick. So it's kind of a funny dance between the feds and the state and the localities. But I think this is going to be an interesting part of you all's debate this year on the role of the federal government, because even though the federal government has traditionally a fairly small share of the financing, and even though, you know, there's nothing in the Constitution about education, many states have, maybe all states, Virginia certainly does, has a constitutional mandate for free and adequate public education.
Yeah,
and certainly the vast majority of states do. But that's all in the state constitutions. What is the role of the federal government? One thing the federal government has jumped in on historically, starting in the 1960s, it created Title I funding, which was meant to do some equalizing on that funding, meant to stream more funds the low-income communities. And with some uneven results. But the other thing that's happened over the last 20 years or so, and this really goes back to President Obama's quote, about other nations out-competing us, which President Bush, his predecessor, very much agreed with. They started thinking of education as a national emergency. And the truth is we've had studies come out over 40, 50 years declaring education a national emergency, but the latest 20-year round of that has been that we are being other countries are out-educating, and we're worried they're going to therefore out-compete us. So the federal government said that is a legitimate interest for us, and we're going to step up our game and started imposing more and more higher and higher expectations as a condition of their funding, basically, is the way the feds have an opportunity to play in that level. Is if you want our money, you've got to meet our higher expectations, and that was No Child Left Behind. No Child Left Behind was the feds setting higher expectations, which then played out at the state level, and the state imposing higher expectations on the localities. All of that led to a lot of conflict and a lot of challenge and a lot of disagreement between those levels of government. And you all, how many folks took a lot of standardized tests during your K-12 career? Regardless of what state you're in, I suspect the answer to that is the same. Were they hard, medium, or easy? Let's see. How many people think they were pretty tough? How many people thought they were super easy? Yeah. And how many, admit it, thought they were kind of medium? So some of them. When my kids were half a generation ahead of you came through, they were all pretty darn easy. But then we've been upping our game, the expectation of the standardized tests. For you bright kids, you know, it doesn't surprise me that not a lot of you thought they were really hard. But for a lot of kids, they are really hard, and for a lot of them, or at least medium hard, depending on your state and your field and what you were taking. A lot of that, there was a lot of backlash to No Child Left Behind, there was a lot of controversy and a lot of question about how much is it the federal role versus the state role. All of that led up to a big public debate that was resolved 2 years ago with the Every Student Succeeds Act.
You know, No Child Left Behind, you guys have all heard of that law, right? It was passed during Bush 2. Some people call it the No Child Left Untested law, because that's we tested kids, we still left a lot of kids behind. ESSA is the sequel. Let me switch gears for a second and give you, and as we think about policies and we think about Every Student Succeeds Act, better known as ESSA, by the way, you know, in politics, and I'll tell you too, everything has an acronym. Everything we do is based upon acronyms. And I think sometimes we pass laws because they have good acronyms associated with it. ESSA is the Every Student Succeeds Act. Another concept in policy that I wanted to put out there for you, here's a debate hint for you, is you're probably going to talk a little bit in your debate about school readiness. Is that something that you thought about putting in your debate, school readiness? Okay, let me give you my wrap on school readiness. Most people, when they speak about school readiness, speak about getting kids ready for school, right? How do we get kids ready for school? When I talk about school readiness, I like to talk about how to get schools ready for kids. I think it's even more important to think about how do we create conditions for success in schools so that schools are ready to help every child to succeed. So I flipped the question. So I suggest to you, as you think about the debate, if you flip the question, if that comes up, you might score a couple of points with the judges, just as a hint. If I were judging the debate, I would score some, give you some points. So if we flip the question and we said that school readiness is about getting schools ready for kids, what do we need to do to be sure schools are ready for kids? What do we need to do? You guys have been students. You guys are the experts. We haven't been in school in a while. We just go into schools and do things with schools. But you're the consumers. Tell us, what is it that we have to do to get schools ready for all kids? Yeah?
Make sure there's enough resources available for, like, all circumstances, all students, to make sure they're succeeding in all of their classes. Make sure they have, like, tutors and
so resources is one important dimension. The schools have the ability, have the fuel to put in their engine. So you mentioned tutors, you mentioned after-school programs. What are some other things you guys can think about if we had resources we put in the schools? Yeah.
Have like the flexibility to be able to like teach every student with like different skills, or if they have like a disability, be able to teach them the same so one person doesn't have to fall.
You ready for individualized learning needs? Yeah.
Good point. I would say that correctly choosing and qualifying teachers, but my experience is I've had too many teachers who knew the material and like in the teaching aspect knew what they were doing, but like with interacting with the students and getting them to learn, actually, like their way of teaching just wasn't effective. And I think like having a degree, just knowing the material isn't enough anymore. So it's wonderful.
Okay. What's the most for you? What's been the most effective instructional approach?
To be engaged with the class, like yes, like if you get up and like give this cool lecture and all the content and like how to do it, there will be people that do listen, but not everyone just listens right off the bat and just absorbs all that info. But when you interact with the class and interact with your peers, you're kind of like getting their attention. And
right.
That's kind of
so kind of learn by doing, learn by interacting, learn by engagement. What are these people think? People agree with that perspective? Do you learn best?
But I want to go back to
sure.
The beginning, too, is to make that happen, to have that kind of effective learning styles, we've got to have great teachers. And so certainly one crucial part of school readiness, right, is to have really high-quality teachers who both know their stuff and know how to motivate students.
And let me tell you, it's a lot tougher to teach. And I'm going to tell you a quick story about that. That's a great point you've made, is that with engaged kids in their learning, if they're discovering as they learn, what happens? And you're learning, what happens? As you learn, you learn better, right? So one of my sons is a teacher. I was telling Ann and I were talking about one of my sons is a phys ed teacher. Everybody ever take phys ed? Everybody took phys ed, right? So when you were in phys ed, and anybody ever take phys ed, you were playing basketball, and the teacher talked about basketball. I asked my son one time, I said, Drew, tell me, so when you're teaching basketball to your high school class, do you stand at the board and put a ball up on the board and put notes on the board about how to dribble and how to shoot? I said, yeah, you're a teacher, you're an educator. He said, are you crazy? That's not how we teach basketball. I said, well, that's how we teach math. We're up there, we put a formula on the board, and why don't you teach basketball the way you push it? You take a ball and you give the kids in the gym a ball, and they're not going to make the basket the first time, but they're going to learn how to dribble, and they're going to shoot, and sooner or later they'll make a basket because they'll be practicing. And I say, well, wait a minute, so you actually give them a task to do, and they're actually dribbling the ball, and they're not perfect the first time? How many of you, the first time you shot a basketball, made a basket the first time? I certainly did. So it's really what you're saying, right? If you can teach basketball by learning how to do the tasks, why can't we teach social studies that way?
How many of you had educational experiences that you, in any significant degree in your schooling today, allowed room for failure, where you actually had to try something that was so hard that you were going to fail in some way, and then have to learn from that and try again, try something different and work with a team maybe and try something different. Has anybody had those kind of project-based learning experiences? Yeah, or whatever you would call them. Where were you?
So I was in a physics class, so this year I took physics and mechanics, and so what we had to do is we had to calculate how to drop a ball from a ramp and get it into a small cup, and no one knew how to do it, and everyone failed, like no one hit the cup. Like I was like a whole meter off. But then our teacher and our class, like we were in separate groups, so we all worked together. And then a few months later, we came back and like everyone got on the cup.
So how would you compare that educational experience to the rest of your K-12 education?
It was definitely frustrating at first because we all failed and it was kind of like a grade. But afterwards, we all learned how to...
I'm sorry, it was frustrating because we all felt like what?
Well, we all kind of failed, and we thought it would be a grade or something.
We thought if we failed, it would be a bad grade.
Yeah.
Okay,
exactly. And so everyone was kind of I guess, very anxious, but afterwards, you're able to learn from your mistakes. You learn better that way.
Right.
And did your teacher grade you down for the early mistake?
No, we didn't get a great grade.
So the teacher got that. She understood.
Yeah.
She?
No, we were supposed to fail.
Because that's life, right? That's what you do all. I mean, if we're doing things we already know how to do, we're not advancing. Oh, I'm sorry, I thought I saw a hand. So anybody else had any educational experiences where failure was part of the process?
Yeah. I just have like a little different perspective, but I'm originally from Korea, and I didn't speak like English at all when I first came here.
Wow.
So like learning English was like definitely a challenge for me, like going through ESOL and all that. And making friends was hard. Like I couldn't speak to them, like I constantly failed. But the teacher always like encouraged me to do better, and I think that's why I'm even here today.
Oh, that's a great story.
And in the end, that makes you stronger, right?
Right, hopefully.
Among other things, you're bilingual, right? Which we all will be jealous of forever, because that's something you'll carry with you. But also, you now know how to overcome. And you know that you can overcome a big challenge. So.
Yes,
ma'am. But that's something that we have to think about. How does ed policy allow for, does ed policy encourage, do our curricular requirements, do our how we train teachers, do the expectations and outcome measures we use for teachers allow and encourage those kind of learning experiences, or do they discourage them?
You know, what we're really talking about is quality in education, school quality. And here's what the data says about quality of schools. Here's another point for your debates. The data, and there's a lot of research that speaks to school quality. Here are the two most important factors that affect the quality of schools. Well, we talked about resources, and resources certainly are one. What are the two most important factors in schools that affect quality? You guys just alluded to it. We're talking about it in the back. Teachers?
And right.
One second.
Students?
Students? Yes, but let's talk about the school itself as opposed to the students here at the school. Think about the two most important ingredients for the success of schools. The quality of teachers, the ability, the capacity, and the performance of teachers. What's the second?
The school environment itself.
School environment itself, really engendered by the leadership of the school. So teachers and school leaders, which speaks to school culture, which speaks to the whole kind of system that is the school, right? And so we know that quality makes a difference. We also know that quality costs, back to one of the points in the back, that you can't do education on the cheap. You have to do it in a way that provides the resources. But quality is probably the biggest factor that drives success of students in performance on things like standardized tests, but more importantly, it drives performance when you finish school. When people come to a university like Mason, who are the students who are succeeding the most? They're students who've had a rich high school experience, who have had a broad range of experiences. Students that learn how to explore, or students that learn how to think creatively. And we think sometimes about skills that are 21st century skills, creativity, collaboration, communication, being able to relate to others. Learning is not just content, learning also is a process. So engaging in schools and teachers working with students, not just on learning how to recite, but learning how to think. Right? Knowledge is one thing, understanding is something else. So school quality. So what are some of the school quality issues? We've got a couple of them up there. What do you think of these, Andy?
Yeah, I think it's a pretty good list. Your thing about what are the top top effects? You said students. I would say the way Mark phrased his question, within the school, what are the top, and he's told you the answer on that. But if you say what is the overall top indicator of student success, it is going to be family.
Oh, absolutely.
And that is what
yeah.
family and student bring to
right.
the table.
Right.
And
sure.
this income disparity issue really is really quite fundamental in our education system here in the States. Here's a statistic that'll be good for your debates, and you'll have to look up to get it exactly right, because I can't quote the source, but I know the number. the number of spoken words that young people have heard before, and maybe Mike and Mark can help me on it.
No, I know the concept.
The number of spoken words that a student has heard when they enter kindergarten. The difference between children from high socioeconomic backgrounds and low socioeconomic backgrounds, 5 million words.
Wow.
How many words have you heard spoken? The good news about that is it's something that's actually fairly simple to help fix if you help young parents. I mean, what we're talking about is intergenerational poverty. We're talking about very young parents who maybe don't have much of the way to parent role models. We're talking about parents who are working and not able to spend as much time with their children. But it's the kind of thing that good early intervention programs can just help encourage. You know what? It's not complicated. You don't have to be teaching your child, you know, higher math when they're three. But if you talk to them, if you sing to them, if you ask them, if you read to them, we've got a number of programs that try to get books into the hands of babies, 6 months old, 1 year olds, and help train parents that it's okay if they're going to eat it. That's what 1 year olds are supposed to do, is put it in their mouth, right? 6 months old, have good hard books, but that's a huge issue that I think permeates everything we do in education policy is the socioeconomic differences and how do we go about addressing them and how do we go about compensating for them.
No, you mentioned in the back over there about English language learners. Students who come to our schools today, Virginia and throughout the country, who are learning English, are coming in greater numbers than ever before. And you're really fortunate that you probably had great teachers to help you to learn English and to adapt to the new country that you've come to. But that's not the case for every student. And not every classroom that has English language learners in it has a teacher that is as qualified as the guy in the back says our teachers are being. And that's something we need to, from a policy perspective, think about how we can do a better job in being sure that all of our children, again, school readiness is about getting schools ready for the kids. Many schools are simply not as ready as they need to be to meet the needs of a particular group of kids who are learning English. Some schools more so than others. So I wanted to highlight that.
The rural versus urban. Anybody here from a more rural community? Yes, and where are you from?
Upstate New York.
And that's where you went to school?
Mm-hmm.
Where upstate? What town?
Sullivan County, like the Catskills.
Yeah.
Yep. Good, good, good. And how about over here?
We're from Arkansas.
But not all of Arkansas is rural, but you're from more rural part of Arkansas. And who?
Like Fauquier.
Yeah.
Okay. A little bit more rural than.
Yeah, and you're also Arkansas. So.
Beautiful county.
So my experience in Virginia is that, interestingly enough, some of our rural high-poverty communities and our urban high-poverty communities think that they're entirely different, but some of their challenges in education are really quite similar because it all comes back to poverty, but that the rural communities have some extra issues on top of that, frankly. The geography in and of itself makes life complicated. You tend to have smaller schools because people are more spread out, so it's harder to have concentrated resources. It's impressive that you have debate teams that send you off to the debate camp, because that doesn't happen in all rural communities. That just the sheer number of offerings, the range of offerings, tends to be less. The rural have poverty communities have all the same issues as the urban ones, and then some.
We talked earlier about many of the decisions about what happens in classrooms, what happens in schools, are made at the local level, which means local school boards need to be well-functioning. They need to have a certain level of expertise. People who are elected to school boards need to have more than interest in education. They need to have knowledge about best practice. And sometimes decisions that are made in schools are made a little bit more for politics than for rationality. We've seen that in some communities around we see that increasingly. We see the politicalization, if you will, of education in ways that has been historic, but I think is accelerating. And that's another question for debate, maybe, that you might be able to think about is from a governance perspective. When you look at the federal role and the state role and the local role, how do we assure ourselves that education is a great equalizer? How do we assure ourselves that schools are generally high functioning across the board? Well, one of the things is that schools need to be well-governed by people in positions of leadership that have the expertise necessary to govern effectively. Let me add one piece here. Let me skip around to a slide. I want to talk too much time about teachers. Some of you mentioned teachers. I wanted to phrase this as a question, but rather than a question, let me give you a statistic. We have here at Mason, to give you an example, the largest college of education in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We graduate.
And one of the best.
And one of the best.
The best.
Thank you. There you go. We graduate more students every year going into the classrooms, in particular in Virginia, than any other university in the state. But what happens when teachers enter the classroom? Here's the interesting national data. 50% of teachers, 50% of new teachers who leave universities like George Mason, left George Mason a month and a half ago after our commencement at the end of May, a month ago actually, 50% of those teachers will leave education within 5 years. 50% of new teachers will leave the field of education within 5 years. Well, we may want to talk in a moment or two about why that's the case, but here's the net effect of that. In 2018, a researcher from Stanford University named Linda Darling Hammond, you may want to write that name down, Linda Darling,
yeah, she's a great resource when you're working on your face, and she has an institute, the name of which I can't remember, but you won't have trouble finding it, that does a lot of policy papers and such.
Yeah, she's probably her institute, and is actually right. If you Google Linda, she has an institute that's been at Stanford and now is also here in D.C., and you can use her materials to really give you good information. Here's one of the things Linda Darling Hammond wrote about 6 or 8 months ago, that by the end of 2018, across the United States, because of this fact that about 50% of teachers leave education within 5 years, and about 4% of teachers nationally, every teacher in every school around the country, there's about an 8% attrition rate generally in schools each and every year. We'll have in the United States by the end of 2018 up to about 100,000 positions for teachers that could go unfilled. Now think about that. About 100,000 teachers across the United States will be needed beyond those that are teachers. So what happens? Think about your school. And think about if there are classes in your school that can't be held because there isn't a teacher.
Or we have, so in Virginia, and it's certainly, we're seeing these teacher shortage issues already, but here in Virginia, in specialty fields, so
right.
shock, math teachers are one of the hardest ones to come by, good math teachers, for all kinds of reasons, partly because folks who are comfortable in the math world can get better man jobs and all kinds of other fields, right? But we'll have classrooms that will go an entire year without a qualified math teacher. Substitutes literally for a whole year. And yet it's a testing subject that requires students to pass. So how crazy is that? But here's an interesting thing we're doing in Virginia, some is starting to be, and more so in our rural communities, right? Especially in our rural communities, certainly in our urban high poverty communities. But one thing we're starting to do is experiment with how can we use technology to expand opportunities. So we've got a pilot of a class going in Virginia that essentially is broadcasting an Algebra 1 teacher across the state, where there's a local teacher who becomes essentially a teacher's assistant. They're not a qualified math teacher, but they can follow along, help grade papers, help assist the student, almost work as a tutor with the actual content delivery coming long distance. May not be an ideal solution. Is it better than having a substitute teacher literally all year long because we don't have a qualified math teacher That's something I think as you all think about, you know, what is the federal role? How can we really get creative to address, I mean, some of the answers, we have to figure out how to pay teachers better. We've been asking our teachers to do more with less, giving them less autonomy, more responsibilities, asking them to really up their game, which we need them to do, serve students with more and more challenges from much more diverse backgrounds, help them meet higher expectations, and yet really because of the recession of 08-09 and all kinds of other factors, we really are paying them in real dollars less. So many teachers are holding down second jobs, et cetera. So so that would be, you know, again, thinking about how can the federal government help affect the funding stream, but remembering it's only 6% of the funding stream. So if you double federal funding in education, well, then you're still almost a cliff. How can we do more money? How can we be more effective policy? How can we find innovative? Can the feds help spark innovations and new ideas? Or can they help leverage state and local dollars, which is a lot of what No Child Left Behind and ESSA, that's kind of been the approach, is how do we use our limited federal dollars to leverage change throughout.
So two quick comments, and I want to talk about two contemporary issues that we're hearing a lot about in the press in the couple of minutes we have left, but two comments just to pick up on Ann's point. One is that if you talk to teachers who leave education, they typically say, I really don't want to leave. I love this job. I don't want to leave, but I can't afford to stay. I can't afford to stay. Second, if they love their job, they say, yeah, I love my job, but I just can't deal with the behavioral problems I have to deal with in classes. They're not wanting to teach, but many teachers don't have the skill set, have developed the skill set in their preparation programs to understand how to manage a group of 25 or 30 kids in a way that is really effective. So what are the big shortage areas? Ann mentioned one, math, and the STEM fields generally, science, technology, engineering, mathematics. Other big areas, special education. We have a very difficult time training sufficient numbers of people to work with children with special needs. ELLs to work with English language learners, but generally we're seeing teacher shortages now across the board, not just in Virginia, but across the country. So let's talk about two other issues before we finish, Ann.
Well, the two I just go very ahead. Quick right. on teacher
sure.
shortage.
Sure.
And yet it's such a great rewarding profession. Anybody here, be honest, anybody here, would you think about going into the teaching profession?
You're right.
Yeah,
more.
A small handful.
Come over and see us while you're here.
Yes. But I ask that to make that point that, you know, it is a little scary to those of us who are watching it and policy flow out over the next couple of decades. We need you and we need more of you.
And it's a great career. It's a great career. It's an enriching career. It's really an enriching career. So you've been following the news. You guys are consumers of the news. You're into the debate world. You know what's happening. Two words come up continually with the new administration when it comes to education. You know what those two words are? Yeah.
School choice.
School choice, exactly. Vouchers, school choice. What's the other? Charters.
Right.
Charters. Who knows what those things would mean?
Anybody here go to a charter school?
Okay.
Where?
Newark and New Jersey, okay.
And all three, did you all three go to the same school?
Okay. Others.
Tell us about your experience. Did you have to make a decision to go to that school, and what grade? How did that fall out for you?
I didn't
want
to. Okay. Oh wow! So you're an early charter school to have been able to be here all three.
Yeah.
And you all as well.
They have different campuses, so we started in fifth grade.
Started fifth grade, but still almost all the way through. And I'm sure you have lots of friends. Well. Do you have friends who didn't make that choice, who went to the regular district schools in your community?
Yeah.
And so what were some of the advantages, what were some of the benefits, what were some of the disadvantages of your experience? A lot of high suspension, a lot of heavy discipline, and not a lot of choice, but a lot of good, strong education going on. Anything else?
Our teachers are very high quality, but it's like a lot of children. We have like a lot of behavior problems in the class, so it kind of like takes away from what we learn, because we learn like at least 2 years ahead of like the other public schools that are around us. But it's just like the kids in our classes, sometimes they take away from the learning that we have, and that kind of leads to the high disciplinary like actions that we have. It kind of takes away from what we're learning.
So you all's experience, I would say, raised two issues that we see systemically about that coming up in the debate about the role of charter schools. And one is their charter critics would say that charter schools are often not dealing with the same range of issues that other schools are because they're just excluding them, that they take kids with discipline problems and kick them out. And therefore can do great success with the students who are left. And yet on the other hand, I would say there are many, many, many charter schools, and it depends on the school and the division, but that are absolutely grappling with many of the same issues that other district schools are. And that's kind of where Virginia, for various reasons, has fairly limited charter experience. But from my window, many of our charter schools have the same issues as our district schools, and until we figure out how to help teachers have effective ways to deal with school discipline issues, for instance, behavior issues, and until we help students be able to deal with those issues, we're not going to have the fix for either charter or district schools.
Yeah. So, Ron, in Virginia, we have, what, two or three charters?
There's actually nine across the state, but only nine in a state of 1,800 schools.
Right. And in the District of Columbia, which is about 10 miles from here, something like that, it's
half and half. So that's an example of education policy at the federal level has incentivized experimentation and innovation.
So that's one of the areas that I'm sure, as you prepare your debate topics and prepare your speeches for debate, you'll probably want to address some of the issues around charters. The other is school choice and vouchers. Talk about vouchers for a second. Vouchers has been a complex issue. Providing parental choice of where to take your local dollars effectively and spend them on education.
And everybody understands the difference that vouchers is money, allowing parents in some way to use their money to go to private schools. And one of the biggest issues, and you know, I know we're out of time, so but one of the biggest issues that comes up there, that if you're going to advocate for a voucher approach, is there are a number of issues, but one of them, the key one is, well, then do you expect those schools to meet the same curricular and outcome expectations for public schools? So if the public is paying for it, do they have to take tests? Do they have to take the same tests? Do they have to accept the same range of students?
Have the same regulatory pressures.
And provide English language learner services and special ed services, et cetera. Those are very, and there's, you can make arguments on both sides of it, because the private school can say, well, wait a minute, we're trying to do something entirely different here. And our curricular goals are different, and that's why the parents chose our school. Wait a minute, if the public is going to pay for it, don't we have some right and expectation, need to know whether you're providing a quality education? And if we don't have all these accountability tools in place, then how do we know we're getting our money? Well, you all are going to have a great year, I know.
Yeah. Big issues. Those are the big issues. What questions do you guys have that we might be able to answer in a minute or two left? Yeah.
You said that the local and state level contribute for the most part to the budget, and that means they have the most power. So how would local and state levels, like, if they wanted to change parts of the school curriculum, how would they go about doing that with federal implementations like Common Core?
Great question.
How would who go about changing
this, like, state annual, like, mainly local level? How would they go about changing parts of the curriculum with, like, federal restrictions and implementation?
Well, so
and
I'm writing this right now. So
there you go. Great question.
I'm no longer Secretary of Education of Virginia, but I'm now on the Board of Education of Virginia, which is the oversight policy board at the state level. So we're like the state equivalent of the local school board, and we're very much wrestling with redoing our curricular expectations, the requirements for graduation, with an eye towards helping connect school more effectively to college and career success. And we're also in the midst of redoing our ESSA plan, the plan that we're required to submit to the feds if we want that 6% money, which we absolutely do. We have to submit a plan that meets the ESSA expectations, and it's very complicated. And we are making decisions, for instance, to lower the number of required verified courses in high school, so that on the one hand, and on the other hand, to increase expectations for high schools to do more career exploration with students, to do more internships, externships in a supervised educational way in high school. We can change the curricular requirements, but we have to fit them within. We can't change them in ways that don't meet the minimum federal test, so we still have to have the feds say we have to test English, math, science at least once in high school. Virginia, actually, our testing requirements go way beyond that. We have to define graduation consistent with the way the feds define graduation. If that's probably a good thing. We now have uniform ways of measuring graduation across the country. We will change those requirements, but how that gets implemented down at the local level is completely up to the schools. So do schools take advantage of the opportunity to do internships and externships? Do they take advantage of the opportunity to emphasize critical thinking and communication skills and collaborations of the five C's that we're telling them to highlight? Do they pull it off? That's going to be up to the local. So it's really a dance that requires all three levels.
Great. We're set out of time.
You guys are great. You're
best of luck, and I hope that you can solve some of these complex problems. You know, through debate, sometimes we find solutions. So take a strong stand, and as you take a stand in your debates, keep one principle in mind, that you've got to be for the students.
Yes, good.
You've got to be student first, and being sure that just as Horace Mann said 150 years ago, that education becomes the greatest important.
Thank you guys, and have a great day.
Yeah, enjoy.
Group's going to be so happy to see a federalism debate.
I can go.
I think that everyone's really had fun.
It's not even just money, it's also